So dear students, we are entering into another very important area of metabolic acidosis. Here it is renal tubular acidosis. We have had a very extensive session, prolonged session for 9 to 10 episodes on acid-base disorders, of which one of them is metabolic acidosis. And renal tubular acidosis is a form of metabolic acidosis. So let us now start off with the renal tubular acidosis discussion. So you know, acidosis is basically of two types, metabolic and respiratory. Among the respiratory, you know, you have acute and the chronic. Today we are not going to go into the acute and chronic respiratory acidosis, but we are going to look at a specific condition of the kidney which is causes metabolic acidosis. Then let us recapitulate what is acidosis. Any pH less than 7.4 is acidemia. Acidemia, pH less than 7.4, and a metabolic condition which is causing a drop in the pH is of course metabolic acidosis. And that is characterized by an increase in the hydrogen ion concentration. The hydrogen ions are held up more in the blood. That is why there is increased hydrogen ion concentration is acidosis, which hydrogen ion concentration inverse log of that is pH. So pH will be lower. And blood bicarbonate is mopped up by the excess hydrogen, and there is a drop in the blood bicarbonate. So the hallmark of the biochemical diagnosis of acidosis, metabolic acidosis, is a pH of less than 7.4, a low bicarbonate. Of course, an increase in the hydrogen concentration is a converse of the pH. Okay, and we also know there will be a secondary variable, which is the PCO2. Which also will move in the same direction as the pH. So pH is lower, bicarbonate is lower, and carbon dioxide also is lower. That is the picture of metabolic acidosis. The moment we know it is metabolic acidosis, we know it can be due to gain of hydrogen ions through ingestion or through metabolism or loss of bicarbonate, either through the kidney or through the gut. Okay, metabolic acidosis is there is a gain of hydrogen ions. How do they come? Metabolically, let us say there is ketoacidosis, diabetic ketoacidosis, starvation ketoacidosis, the keto acids, alpha hydroxy butyric acid, beta hydroxy butyric acid, acetoacetic acid, these are all accumulated and that produces gain in hydrogen ions. Or there could be lactic acidosis because of ischemia, because of sudden cardiac arrest, or because of limb ischemia, whatever is the reason. Lactic acidosis, starvation ketoacidosis, alcohol related ketoacidosis, diabetic ketoacidosis, renal acidemia, renal causes causing accumulation of acid, all will relate to gain in the acid. The bicarbonate can be lost when kidney is not able to recapture or reclaim the bicarbonate due to a defect in the acid synthesis, acid production in the kidney, which is renal tubular acidosis. Or the bicarbonate may be lost through the GI tract, as in case of diarrhea, as in case of enteric fistulas, as in case of pancreatic fistula, whatever it is. Okay, metabolic acidosis, you have the acronyms, the mud piles and the hardup. The mud piles for the AGMA and the NAGMA, given by the hardup or used cause. You know that, the causes. So it could be a gain in the hydrogen ion or a loss in the bicarbonate. So when we now know that we have AGMA, anion gap, of course we are not dealing with carbon dioxide retention due to respiratory depression, depressant drugs, injuries, pleurisy, cerebrovascular causes, which produce retention of carbon dioxide and thereby produce acidosis. That acidosis is respiratory acidosis, which is not the discussion topic now. We keep that away for a while. It's very important. And acute respiratory acidosis could be fatal and immediately requires intubation and life-saving measures. We keep it aside. Now, we come to the metabolic acidosis. Under metabolic acidosis, we have two parts, the anion gap metabolic acidosis and the non-anion gap metabolic acidosis. You know how to calculate the anion gap, sodium minus the sum of bicarbonate plus chloride. Normally it should be 10 or 12 at the most. Anything more than that is increased anion gap. That is called the delta anion gap. When that gap is within 12 or 10, that is called non-anion gap metabolic acidosis. Okay, now this anion gap metabolic acidosis can be due to exogenous poisons like, you know, salicylates, methanol, isopropyl alcohol, ethanol, paraldehyde, isoniazid. These are all taken from outside, exogenous causes of AGMA. Then you have the endogenous causes, diabetic ketoacidosis, starvation ketoacidosis, alcohol-associated ketoacidosis, renal acidosis, and any of these conditions, which can lactic acidosis. These are all endogenous causes. AGMA may have exogenous causes. Most of them can be obtained from the history itself. And to segregate the AGMA, you require to do what is called the delta osmolal gap. And compare that with the anion gap and you make a differential diagnosis. We all know that. When we come to the NAGMA, we have got, there are two major causes, gut-related and renal tubular acidosis. Gut-related, then here the test we do is urine anion gap. Okay. If the urine anion gap is negative, it is gut, it is positive, or more normally also it is positive, overwhelmingly positive, more than 30, then we have what is called the renal tubular acidosis. This is the basic differential diagnosis of metabolic acidosis. All of you have really been, I mean, given the chance to understand very well. Those of you who have not done the homework, read again, listen to the videos and answer the questions. None of you have submitted the 6 questions which are given. They are not given for my sake. They are given for your sake. I do not know for whose permission you are waiting to answer those questions. Please forthwith answer them and submit in today or tomorrow. Okay? Otherwise, you are not understanding what is being talked about. I am very firm about that. You have to give the answers. Right or wrong, does not matter. You have to give the answers. Okay? This is the basic understanding of metabolic acidosis as presented on this slide as clearly as possible. Now, let us get into this particular area, renal tubular acidosis. Okay. How does acid enter the body without being consumed from outside? The metabolism of food adds acid to the body. What type of foods we have? Carbohydrates, fats, proteins represented by the amino acids. The carbohydrates and fats, when they're metabolized, you know the Krebs citric acid cycle and the Emden-Meyerhoff pathway and all that. Ultimately, The end product is carbon dioxide and water and energy. The metabolism of fat and carbohydrate takes a route, the end product of which is carbon dioxide and water and energy. Energy is used for metabolic needs or conserved for future usage, and if excess carbohydrate and fat is there, that too is conserved in the liver without being burned to carbon dioxide and water, and whatever that is burned produces carbon dioxide. We know the acids are of two types, volatile acids and fixed acids. Volatile acid, the best volatile acid we have in our body is carbon dioxide. And this is a product of, this volatile acid is a product of carbohydrate and fat metabolism. Who takes care of this acid? We have the beautiful respiratory mechanism. Lungs can excrete the carbon dioxide. That is what exactly is the respiration? Excreting the metabolic waste carbon dioxide and giving back the oxygen required for the tissues is the respiration. How much is excreted? 15,000 milliequivalents per day. The carbon dioxide that is produced is equivalent to 15,000 milliequivalents of acid. And carbon dioxide, when dissolved, becomes carbonic acid, H2CO3. That, when dissociates, becomes water and carbon dioxide. The carbon dioxide is thrown out through the lungs and water is excreted through the kidney. That is how the acid load of carbonic acid, a volatile acid, which is gaseous state, and it becomes carbon dioxide and then excreted in the lungs to the tune of 15,000 milliequivalents per day. Then what about the fixed acids? The fixed acids are due to the amino acid metabolism or protein metabolism. So I'm not talking about acids added from outside. These are normally what is being available in the body. The amino acid metabolism throws the fixed acids into the system, and the kidney needs to excrete. Of course, fixed acids cannot be cleared by the lung because they are not volatile, they are not in the gaseous state, and lungs cannot take care of it, and kidney has to take care of it. How much? 1 milliequivalent per kg, roughly around 60 to 70 milliequivalents is the fixed acid excreted, compared to 15,000 milliequivalents of acid excreted through the lung. That is why respiratory depression very quickly produces acidosis, because a large quantity of acid is excreted through the lung and a small quantity of acid, comparatively, that to fixed acid is only excreted by the kidney. But these fixed acids, though small in number, they are very important because they cannot be eliminated by the lungs, and kidney is the only where we can handle them. So, acid-base balance initially neutralizes the blood bicarbonate instantaneously, and that reduces the bicarbonate. The bicarbonate has to be generated back or claimed back or reabsorbed back into the system. That doesn't occur due to renal disease, acidosis prevails. In a normal kidney, the bicarbonate resorption or bicarbonate generation is so quick that the pH is not disturbed and there is an acid-base balance occurs. But in disease, this is not the case. So obviously, metabolic acidosis prevails. That buffer of bicarbonate has to be replenished by generation of the bicarbonate. Either it is produced or it is resorbed more in the kidney. Okay? Or by throwing out the acid, at least 1 milliequivalent of acid is produced. If I'm able to throw that extra acid of 1 milliequivalent per kilogram from the kidney, through the kidney, then of course also the balance can be restored. So the acid-base balance in metabolic acidosis can be obtained by, one, regeneration or reclaiming the bicarbonate, or resorbing the bicarbonate, or secreting the bicarbonate, or generating the bicarbonate, bicarbonate production, two, by excretion of the acid. Okay, now let's go further. I'll go very slowly so that you will be able to understand easily. There are any questions you note down, and I prefer you ask some questions rather than passive listeners. Renal tubular acidosis is characterized by two important problems. The kidney is not able to excrete the acid and not able to generate or resorb enough base. We knew that there are three mechanisms. One, generate bicarbonate. Two, resorb bicarbonate. What is being excreted in the lumen, claim it back. Three, excrete acid. All of them may be at fault. Either it is not able to generate bicarbonate by production and resorption, or it is not able to excrete the acid. That is the basic defect. Then, what is the resulting clinical syndrome? It leads to metabolic acidosis. That we know. And that metabolic acidosis is not the anion gap type. It is the non-anion gap type. Because there are no other added anions other than the metabolic acidosis here is non-anion gap. We are not having salicylate, we are not having pyrrolidate, we are not having ethylene glycol, neither we are having diabetic ketoacidosis or any of the conditions which add other anions other than chloride and bicarbonate. So that is why it is called non-anion gap metabolic acidosis. So then the bicarbonate and chloride only have to balance between themselves. If the bicarbonate is going down, the chloride has to increase and then compensate for the anions there. Because the other anions are not added, because it is a non-gap acidosis, the acidosis here is shown in the form of drop in the bicarbonate and associated hyperchloremia. This is to match the decreasing bicarbonate. So if you see a metabolic acidosis, non-anion gap means the chloride is higher. Hyperchloremic acidosis. Hyperchloremia doesn't produce acidosis. Hyperchloremia is a consequence of NAGMA. Okay? And if you look at the urine, because normally the urine is acidic, it is not alkaline. Just unlike the blood. Blood is slightly alkaline. 7 is the neutral pH. 7.4 is the alkaline pH. Slightly alkaline. But here, urine is acidic normally. Okay? And that acidic, because to excrete the hydrogen ion, urine has to be excreted, hydrogen ion has to be excreted in the kidney, through the kidney. That is why you have an acid urine. The bicarbonate concentration of the urine is very low. That is why we don't reckon it when we are doing the urine anion gap. If you remember the urine anion gap, we add sodium plus potassium and subtract chloride from that, and not the bicarbonate, because bicarbonate is not much in the urine. So anyway, the improper acidification of the urine, and that it is not properly made acid. That means urine is not normally, which should be acidic. It is not that acidic, or it might slowly be higher. So the mechanisms here in renal tubular acidosis are: one, there is non-anion gap acidosis, which can be seen by non-anion gap, low bicarbonate, low pH, secondary low carbon dioxide, and there is hyperchloremic acidosis, because in order to match for the low carbonate, and the acidification of urine is at fault. Urine is not is acidic to the extent we expect. These are the clinical biochemical, clinico-biochemical features. The pathology is, the pathogenesis is one and two. Bicarbonate is not generated or resorbed. Acid is not excreted. One of the two mechanisms. The resulting clinico-biochemical picture: non-anion gap metabolic acidosis as seen by normal anion gap of 10 to 12, and the bicarbonate is lower, pH is lower, and the secondary variable PCO2 also is lower. And this is featured by hyperchloremia because to compensate for the low bicarbonate, there is no other anion here. So the anion that is available, chloride, is retained to match that. That is why hyperchloremic acidosis. And there is improper acidification in the urine, which results in the urine being less acidic than expected. Now, how does the kidney maintain the acid-base balance? So the renal maintenance of acid-base balance, if we understand, then we see what is the abnormality in renal tubular acidosis. Resorption of the all filtered bicarbonate, I told you that very little or traces of bicarbonate is excreted, which means that almost all the filtered bicarbonate is claimed back or resorbed. Regeneration of the bicarbonate lost through the food metabolism, or what is lost through the GI tract or whatever it is. But here we are dealing with RTA, so GI is not involved. So the filtered bicarbonate resorption and production of new bicarbonate, they both involve hydrogen secretion, initially to reabsorb the filtered bicarbonate, later to generate the new bicarbonate. So what will happen? Hydrogen secretion has to occur. Then initially the resorption will take place. And once the resorption is being matched, then there'll be time for the bicarbonate to be generated. That is the third mechanism. Okay. The secreted hydrogen ion, why hydrogen ion is secreted? Hydrogen ion is secreted to claim back the bicarbonate. So hydrogen easily combines with the bicarbonate and forms carbonic acid, which is absorbed back into the system. Or this hydrogen that is secreted can combine with NH3 and then become ammonia and get excreted. So we are throwing acid out, so the acidosis is correct. So for reclaiming the bicarbonate, we require hydrogen. For excreting the acid, we require the hydrogen to be secreted into the lumen. So there is what is called the NAE, net acid excretion, NAE. It is equivalent to titratable acids, plus ammonia, which is also acid, minus the alkali that is sent out. The alkali is bicarbonate. Very, very little of bicarbonate is sent out. So much so, mostly this is the one that is there because this is not very, very powerful. It is not very much excreted there. So titratable acids plus ammonia. So titratable acids are also fixed. What are titratable acids? Mostly phosphate. And then they don't vary much. So the net acid excretion is almost ammonia excretion. So NAE is equal to titratable acids plus ammonia, the sum minus bicarbonate. We know that not much of bicarbonate is lost in the urine. So much so, titratable acids are also constant. So net acid excretion is dependent upon the ammonia excretion, which is again dependent upon the secretion of the hydrogen. Because for the ammonia to go, NH3 cannot go. It has to become ammonia, then it becomes ammonium chloride or whatever it is, and then gets excreted. So net acid excretion is dependent upon the ammonia excretion. Okay. So we'll go further on that. The amount of titratable acid is fixed. And it is the phosphate in the urine is the titratable acid, rarely sulfates and other acids, but mostly it is the phosphate. In contrast, the amount of ammonia produced varies very greatly. So what is the one that is most easily amenable for manipulation? Not titratable acid, not bicarbonate washout, but it is actually, in fact, in acidosis, bicarbonate is claimed back and whatever normally is being excreted, that also is stopped. So the net titratable acid is definitely depends on the ammonia. So the amount of ammonia produced varies greatly depending upon whether there is what is prevailing in the blood. If there is more acidosis, ammonia has to go out like that. But in renal tubular acidosis, this mechanism is at fault. That is why the acid is retained. The ammonia could be dramatically high in other causes of acidosis. Okay? Because the TA is fixed, a decrease in the net acid excretion is decrease in the ammonia excretion. An increase in the net acid excretion is an increase in the ammonia excretion. Why? Because my TA is fixed and we don't lose much of bicarbonate. So in that equation, titratable acid is fixed. This is not much alterable. So we are left with ammonia. So the total acid excretion, net acid excretion, is dependent upon the ammonia. Filtered bicarbonate is approximately, how much bicarbonate is filtered normally? 24 milliequivalents is there in the blood, and 180 is the GFR, 24 into the glomerular filtration rate, which boils down to 4,000 to 5,000 milliequivalents per day, is approximately filtered. Approximately filtered bicarbonate is 4,000 to 5,000 milliequivalents per day, right? After that, 90% is reabsorbed in the proximal tubule itself. Otherwise, all of us will lose bicarbonate and within no time, we will die, because loss of bicarbonate is extreme acidemia and nobody will survive. If the kidney is not claiming back 90% of the bicarbonate, 90% of this 4,000 will roughly boil down to 3,600 milliequivalents to 4,500 milliequivalents is absorbed in the PCT itself. So roughly around 400 to 500 milliequivalents is left for handling in the distal part of the nephron. Okay? So you understand what is NAE and what is the normal filtered bicarbonate and how the kidney reclaims for the body 90% in the PCT and only around 400 to 500 milliequivalents is available for manipulation in the remaining part of the convoluted tubules in the nephron. Now, we have to come to the proximal tubular regulation first. Okay? The proximal, you see the nephron here in the bottom here. This is the glomerulus there and the proximal convoluted tubule. And then after that, the descending loop of the Henle, the loop of the Henle, the ascending loop of the Henle, it has got two components. One is called the thin component, one is called the thick component. They behave differently. The thick ascending loop of the Henle is important, then the distal convoluted tubule, then the collecting ducts, then the major collecting ducts, and finally the intermediary collecting ducts. Small collecting ducts getting into the intermediary and major collecting ducts. Okay? This is the nephron structure. And the renal tubule plays a very important role in the regulation of electrolytes, the regulation of fluid, and in the regulation of acid-base balance. Needless to say that we will be going into all these three areas, starting with the renal tubular acidosis. We are going to look at the nephron handling of the electrolytes and also the hypernatremia, hyponatremia, and other conditions, electrolyte conditions, and finally, the fluid handling by the kidney. Okay. Now let us come to the renal proximal tubular cell. So this renal proximal tubule, this is the proximal tubule. There are the cells lining that are there. So there is what is called the luminal part, and this is the blood part. This is where the blood is circulating. So this is called the luminal part and the blood part. This is the blood side and this is the lumen side. Okay, there is a lumen side and there is a blood side. Okay, Now, the movement of ions from the lumen into the blood through the cell is not passive. It's not passive. They cannot just enter the blood just like that from the lumen and cross the tubular cell and enter the plasma. There are several gates there, and these are the checkposts or gates which are essential for acid-base regulation and electrolyte regulation and all that. And what are these gates? We need to know that. Okay? And the major important enzyme is carbonic anhydrase. And there are two types of carbonic anhydrases we now come across. Here, in fact, there are many types of carbonic anhydrases. And here, what is useful is carbonic anhydrase 2 and carbonic anhydrase 4. Okay? So, this is called the luminal side, also called the apical side. This is called the blood side, also called the basolateral side. Why it is called like that? If you look at the cell is like that. This is called the apex of the cell is into the lumen, and the basolateral part is onto the blood. So, the cell is somewhat tapering apically into the lumen with the basolateral membrane on the plasma side. So, the basolateral side is this side, though it is a rectangle here. Imagine the cell will be not a rectangle, but it will be like that. And the apical side is towards the lumen. Now, there is bicarbonate in the lumen. Because how much is bicarbonate? Bicarbonate 24 into 180 to 200. GFR is around 4,000 to 5,000 is filtered, and that bicarbonate cannot go out. It has to be reabsorbed. We know that 90% of this reabsorption occurs in the proximal tube. Otherwise, we will die in no time. Okay, how is this reabsorbed? This bicarbonate, sodium, it's in the form of sodium bicarbonate, is split into sodium and bicarbonate. Okay. For the sodium to enter into the cell, there is a checkpost. That checkpost is called sodium hydrogen exchanger 3. NHE3. Sodium hydrogen. N is sodium. H is hydrogen. E is exchanger. 3 is the type of receptor there. The type of gate there. NHE3 receptor or NHE3 gate is there. The moment sodium want to enter, the checkpost will ask, okay, you are going in, but I want somebody to come out in your in exchange for you. And preferably, I want the hydrogen to come out. Because a cation is entering, a cation has to come. The commonly available cation is hydrogen. So the cation of hydrogen moment out, sodium, it is like, you know, you will be entering in the park, there will be a wheel-like thing with four flanges. And you enter one side and automatically a person standing on the other side will be come out. A person wants to come out, he will stand in one of those four quadrants. A person wants to enter in one of the quadrants, if you turn it, the person outside will go in and the person inside will come out. Exactly like that. NHE is a rotating type of receptor. The moment it takes the sodium in, the hydrogen which is there, the other side, it comes out. Okay, what has happened? We have absorbed the sodium. What will happen to the sodium? We will see later on. Now what we are left with in our bicarbonate? We are left with the bicarbonate ion. Sodium bicarbonate, sodium is taken away, the bicarbonate is left out. This bicarbonate has to be claimed back. There is no direct receptor for the bicarbonate. So just like that, get enter into the cell. On the apical side, there is no receptor. There is no one who accept. It goes and touches the apical side and asks, I want to go in. No, you don't have a passport. Your passport is not valid. You better stay there. Then what it does is the hydrogen has come out, not just now. It catches hold of that hydrogen. That hydrogen and so bicarbonate together will form carbonic acid. And this carbonic acid is formed in the lumen, and there is an enzyme, a facilitator there, a broker. No, don't worry, I will make you enter. I will first couple you with the carbon dihydrogen and make you by carbonic acid, and then I will cut you into two parts which are easily absorbable, water and carbon dioxide. So water and carbon dioxide is formed. Water goes down depending on the necessity, either it is reabsorbed or excreted. That is a different mechanism. Now the carbon dioxide is ready, and that can diffuse. Being a gas, it can easily diffuse into the cell, because for oxygen and carbon dioxide, cell membrane is directly permeable. So what happened? The bicarbonate, which is impermeable by the apical side of the cell membrane, being impermeable to bicarbonate, this bicarbonate, which is generated from the sodium bicarbonate, after leaving the sodium to the fate of hydrogen, sodium entered inside, came out, and it makes friends with the hydrogen. That becomes carbonic acid, and there is a person there to help them. That is carbonic anhydrase 4, which cleaves the, which is a reversible reaction. So it can combine H and HCO3 to become carbonic acid, which becomes, in this direction, the reaction proceeds. Carbon dioxide and water are produced. Water is reabsorbed or excreted in the lumen, left in the lumen, depending on the necessity of the body, as decided by other mechanisms. Most of it is absorbed, of course, because we need to claim most of our glomerular filtrate, because we excrete around 180 ml into 24 hours into 60. That is the water filtered. 180 ml of water is filtered, 60 per minute, 60 minutes is 1 hour, 24 hours is 1 day. This is something around a huge number, and only 1% of that is allowed to go out. That we will look at when we come there. Anyway, the water is also reabsorbed. It's permeable to water, it goes. The carbon dioxide goes into the cell, and water also has entered. This carbon dioxide and water, now there is another enzyme, just the reverse of carbonic anhydrase 4. This produces the bicarbonate. It makes them into carbonic acid. And this carbonic acid, by the same Ca2, is catalyzed, is split into hydrogen ion and bicarbonate. Okay, net result, what has happened? This bicarbonate has entered and came here. This bicarbonate here, which is in the form of sodium bicarbonate, has come and been into the cell. Though this is not allowed, it used a mechanism through the carbonic anhydrase and through the apical cell, it has come in. This hydrogen that is coming out from this, this is useful by sending it out. Who sends it out? Either it can get exchanged to sodium, but enough sodium is not available, there is another mechanism called HATPase. What is that? That is a energy gated channel. For the hydrogen to go out, it goes there and asks, I want to go into the lumen. Then you go through the sodium channel. No. Sodium channel is very busy, and sodium is being brought in, and only one can go, one sodium can go for one hydrogen. So I want to go out. Then you require energy, get some energy. So energy is there, ATP is there. That ATP is broken down by ATPase. Using that energy, the gate is open now, and the hydrogen enters into the lumen. That's how the hydrogen from the ATPase and the hydrogen that is secreted with the NHe3, both are there, and this hydrogen is useful to reclaim more bicarbonate in the same fashion. Okay, now we have seen how NHe3 works, how HATPase works, where exactly it works, how Ca4 works, and how Ca2 works. Now, what did we gain of all? We got the sodium inside, and we got our bicarbonate inside. That's what we wanted to get in. We want to bring in that sodium bicarbonate here. The body has brought it. Then how does the sodium go? Can they combine now and go into the blood? No. Again, there is no receptor for sodium bicarbonate as such, either on the apical side or on the basolateral side. They have to be absorbed again separately as sodium and bicarbonate. Okay, that is called the NBCE, that is called sodium bicarbonate combined channel. So that sodium bicarbonate, the combined channel, one sodium, three bicarbonate escape into that. That channel has to be opened. Okay, so we have got, let us say, three sodiums have come inside. Let us say one of them goes there and two go in exchange for potassium. So potassium is brought in. There is another channel, sodium potassium ATPase channel, which is again energy dependent channel. The two potassium move in, two sodium go out, one sodium has coupled with the bicarbonate and three bicarbonate, and that is by the NBCE1. So as such, sodium bicarbonate as such cannot go, and it has to use a symporter. A symporter is the one which takes two ions, sodium ion and the bicarbonate ion, separately, and in one way, one direction only, it pushes them inside. NBC, sodium bicarbonate combined receptor, okay? Combined exchanger, exchanger one, NBCE1 and sodium potassium ATPase channel. So the net result is sodium bicarbonate is brought onto the blood. So around so much amount of 4,000 to 5,000 milliequivalents is filtered. 90% of that sodium bicarbonate is conserved and brought back into the blood. This is how the proximal tubule reabsorbs the sodium bicarbonate. On the apical side, NHe3 sodium hydrogen exchanger 3 and HATPase send the hydrogen into the lumen and take the sodium through the NHe3 into the cell. The taken hydrogen combines with the HCO3 to form H2CO3, which is catalyzed by carbonic anhydrase 4 to become water and carbon dioxide. Water and carbon dioxide readily enter into the cell. There, carbonic anhydrase 2 synthesizes them into carbonic acid, which is a weaker acid. And this again requires a carbonic anhydrase 2 again, which splits them into bicarbonate and hydrogen. The bicarbonate has to go into the blood, hydrogen has to go into the lumen to bring in more fellows like this. That hydrogen tries to compete with the sodium and go through the NHe channel. If that channel is busy, it uses the other channel, which is energy dependent channel. Earlier it was an exchanger, here it is an energy based channel. So that channel allows the hydrogen, either one of the two channels, get into the lumen and bring more bicarbonate in the form of carbon dioxide and water. The bicarbonate that has come into the cell and the sodium that has come into the cell, there are two mechanisms. On the basal side or basolateral side, you have sodium bicarbonate combined exchanger 1. That takes one sodium, if it allows, it can allow three bicarbonate. The channel is programmed like that. So there are two more sodium fellows left. They get exchanged in turn with the two potassiums here by the NaKATPase. Net result is potassium is an intracellular ion. It moves here and sodium bicarbonate is claimed into the blood. I hope you have understood this part. Now, let us go to the next slide. That is what is happening in the proximal tubule. There is what is called the collecting tubule and collecting duct. CT, collecting duct, CD. This is one unit, collecting tubule and collecting duct. The collecting duct, the main role of acid-base bioregulation is in the collecting duct. It fine-tunes the acid excretion and base conservation. Already 90% of the base is conserved there. It fine-tunes the remaining base conservation and pushing more acid into the lumen. And remember, there are three types of cells that are there: alpha intercalated cells, beta intercalated cells, and then the principal cells. They're also called A intercalated, B intercalated, alpha intercalated, means the same. Alpha intercalated cells, beta intercalated cells, and principal cells. there are three types of cells. The role of each one of that is different. Alpha intercalated cells, they secrete acid. That means they get rid of the acid from the body. Beta intercalated cells secrete the base. That means they get rid of the excess base if necessary. If excess acid is there, alpha intercalated cells work. If excess base is there in the body due to metabolic alkalosis, beta intercalated cells come in. And principal cells reserve water, sodium, and secrete potassium. And these are the three important cells. And this resorption of sodium, water, and secretion of potassium is also important for acid-base balance. That is why we need to know alpha intercalated cell, beta intercalated cell, and the principal cell. So let us see each one of them. Alpha intercalated cells, AIC, I have designated them. These secrete acid into the lumen. And primarily by apical HATPase. What is the gate it uses? Primarily on the apical side, that is luminal side, there is a HATPase gate. And that HATPase or HKATPase. It could be simply HATPase or it could be a HKATPase, which is an exchange for the potassium. A simple gate allowing hydrogen alone or a gate which claims potassium and allows hydrogen. Both are possible. Mainly HATPase. Where is that? It is in the alpha intercalated cells. Where are they? They are in the collecting tubes and collecting ducts. Which side of the cell? On the apical side of the collecting duct cell. Okay, thus, generate new carbonate under the influence of carbonic anhydrase 2. How does that happen? Once the H goes out into the lumen, we know carbon bicarbonate is generated in the previous slide we knew. By the same mechanism, carbon dioxide is brought into the cell. And that bicarbonate that is generated in the cell is brought into the blood. Which enzyme is required? In the cytosol of the cell, there is carbonic anhydrase 2. There is no carbonic anhydrase 2 in the lumen. Carbonic anhydrase 2 is a cytosolic enzyme. Carbonic anhydrase 4 is a luminal enzyme. Okay. Now, generated carbon dioxide is transported by the basolateral side. On the basolateral side, there in the previous place, we were using sodium and bicarbonate to go inside. Here instead of sodium, there is a chloride bicarbonate exchanger in the collecting tubule or the collecting duct. There in the proximal tubule, as if you remember, we have seen that. Here it is the sodium exchanger. There and here in the collecting duct, it is a chloride bicarbonate exchanger or kidney anion exchanger 1. There is another channel called the KAE1 or simply called AE1. Anion exchanger 1 or chloride bicarbonate exchanger 1 are there in the basolateral part. What is their function? Whatever bicarbonate is claimed into the cell by the action of carbon dioxide, I mean carbonic anhydrase, it has become carbonic acid and that dissociated bicarbonate has to go into the blood. That is facilitated by, on the basolateral side, by the chloride bicarbonate exchanger or AE1 exchanger. So we don't write K because the K usually denotes potassium. You may mistake for that. So we just write AE exchanger. AE means anion exchanger. Okay. These alpha intercalated cells, where are they? They are located in the collecting ducts and the collecting tubules of the cortical nephrons. Suppose there are collecting ducts in the medullary nephrons, there also they are there. But the alpha intercalated cells are maximum located along the cortical as well as the medullary collecting duct. So it's a universal function. There are some cortical nephrons with the tubes in the cortex, some nephrons which are there in the cortex and the tubes are in the medulla, and the cortical and medullary tubules differ to a great extent in terms of water conservation. Here, these are present both in the cortex and in the medulla, and alpha intercalated cells are there, aligning the cortical as well as the medullary CT. Then the beta intercalated cells are there confined to the cortical nephrons, but they're absent in the medullary nephrons. That is the basic difference. What is all this? What is these alpha intercalated cells doing? Net result is bicarbonate brought into the system, into the blood, or bicarbonate conservation. Okay, so the alpha intercalated cell, it secretes these secrete acid into the lumen. How does the secrete use the HATP channel, apical HATP channel, and push the H into the lumen? That H combines with the bicarbonate there, becomes carbonic acid, which dissociates into carbon dioxide and water, which is readily absorbed into the cell. Or it can use HKATPase also. Thus, the bicarbonate that is generated in the cell, in the cytosol, by the action of carbonic anhydride residue, this bicarbonate needs to be transported from the cell, the collecting duct cell, to the blood through the basolateral membrane. There are two exchangers are there. One chloride bicarbonate exchanger, the other is the anion exchanger. Either one of the two mechanisms it uses in the CT and the CD. It's not sodium related here, or potassium related here, unlike in the proximal tubule. Okay, these alpha intercalated cells, where are they? They are in the CT, which are there in the cortex as well as in the medulla. Okay, and the beta intercalated cells are there in the cortical CT alone, but they're absent in the medullary CT. What is the net output of all this action? Pulling back the carbonate from the lumen into the cell, from the cell into the blood, which is called carbonate conservation. Okay. So alpha intercalated cells secreted the acid into the lumen. That acid can either be taken by the bicarbonate to claim the bicarbonate, or that hydrogen ion can combine with ammonia to form ammonia ion, or any other titratable acid it can combine, mainly the phosphate. So it can form any other titratable acid or ammonia. We know other titratable phosphates will be there, hydrogen phosphate will be the titratable acid there, and it can combine with the phosphate to form a hydrogen phosphate, which is the titratable acid, but the capacity is small, maximum by NH3 plus H. So the H that is pushed into the lumen, either it can claim the bicarbonate through the previous process which we saw, or if the bicarbonate absorption is good enough, then the H has to go, and that can join with the ammonia there, ammonia, and form the ammonium ion or other titratable ion, which is mainly phosphate. Hydrogen phosphate is the excretory product. Phosphate excretion is constant in the urine. The ammonia level vary, stimulated by the acidemia. If there is more acid in the blood, more ammonia is in the lumen, and that ammonia is excreted as the ammonium ion. Okay. Now, beta intercalated cells. Beta intercalated cells, or we will see the alpha intercalated cell function. Okay. So this is the alpha intercalated cell. So what is it? We know that there are two channels it is operating. One, the energy dependent HATPase or HKATPase. HKATPase obviously brings K inside, K, and then pushes H outside. Here, there is no problem. Only H can go out and no other exchange is required. What is this ATPase? ATP breaking down into ADP and phosphate, and that is the energy. Using this energy, somebody is using the muscle power, the energy there, to open the gate, and the hydrogen is sent out. Where from this hydrogen has come? By the dissociation of the carbonic acid. How does this come? This is there because of the, we have got the carbon dioxide plus water, and that has become the inside carbonic acid, and that is dissociated by Ca2, and hydrogen is produced, and which is sent out by the HATPase and HKATPase on the luminal side, and This is the blood side, basolateral side. Basolateral side is the blood, is the blood side B here. Apical side is the luminal side. Remember always basolateral blood, and the other one is of course the lumen. Lumen, you know, is the apical side. So this bicarbonate has to be exchanged. How does it this get exchanged? There is an exchanger. AEA, that is the bicarbonate, is exchanged to chloride. And this is called the anion exchanger 1. The channel is called the chloride bicarbonate exchanger or anion exchanger 1. This is on the basolateral side. Okay, the net result is bicarbonate here is climbed here, is brought here through this process. Okay. This is the function of the alpha intercalated cell. Then we go to the beta intercalated cell. So we now know there are three types of cells in the collecting ducts, in the collecting tubules, the alpha intercalated cells, the beta intercalated cells, and the principal cells. The beta intercalated cells are present on the cortical nephron, tubules only, collecting ducts only. They're absent in the medullary, which we have seen in the previous slide. They secrete bicarbonate into the tubular lumen, just the reverse of that. Earlier, the alpha intercalated cells are claiming the bicarbonate from the lumen and putting into the blood. Here, these have an ability to put the bicarbonate into the lumen in exchange for the chloride. Because this is also an anion, this is also an anion. There is an exchange of chloride and bicarbonate. The net result is bicarbonate is secreted or pushed into the lumen from the cell, means from the blood. Into the cell, from the blood it comes, and from the cell it enters into the lumen. So just the opposite of alpha intercalated cell. Depending on if there is excess bicarbonate in the body in alkalosis, these gates are open. These cells function. And they are not, they are absent in the medullary, they are only in the cortical tubule. Using the apical chloride bicarbonate exchanger, it has got a specific name that is called the pendrin. Pendrin is the gate, name of the gate, or the name of the owner of the gate. And that gate is, it allows chloride into the cell, the tubular, I mean collecting tubular cell, and sends the bicarbonate into the lumen. Intracellular hydrogen generated is transported into the blood by the basolateral HATPA. By this, when bicarbonate goes into the lumen, the H is remaining. H plus HCO3 is the molecule, and the remaining H is transported into the blood on the basolateral side. That means bicarbonate is sent out and acid is claimed when there is metabolic alkalosis. When the acid has to be claimed, and the alkali has to be sent, this beta intercalated cell gate works. Net result is bicarbonate is excreted and hydrogen is conserved. This is the beta intercalated cell. See how intricate these functions are. God has created the cells in such a way, depending on the state, whether it is acidemia or alkalemia, either beta intercalated cell or alpha intercalated cell is used to balance the bicarbonate hydrogen ions in the blood. If there is excess of acid, the A cells work. The excess of base, the B cells work. Then let us see the function of the this one. Okay. These are the B cells. B cells, we know this is the blood side, basolateral side, basolateral blood, this is the lumen side, or the apical side. And I told you that the owner there is pendrin. And that pendrin, just like the gate near the gardens, you know, it did not allow the cattle and all, only men have, people have to push it. That's a rotating gate, wherein what will happen? The chloride will come in, and bicarbonate is in exchange to bicarbonate. Chloride moves in, bicarbonate goes out. Where from this bicarbonate came? It came from the H2CO3. That has become bicarbonate. Now the H is available. This H is by an energy transport. ATP into converted into ADP and the energy. And there is an energy proton channel is there. So the proton is not exchanged to any other cation there. It is just pushed into the cell. This is the mechanism in the B type of cells, beta intercalated cells. Now let us go to the principal cells. The principal cells, hydrogen secretion by the ATPase is modulated by the activity of the epithelial sodium channel, ENAC, in the principal cells and by the angiotensin II, aldosterone, and calcium sensing receptor. Hitherto, the alpha and the beta cells are not under the influence of any endocrinal factors. Aldosterone, angiotensin, calcium sensing receptor, they got nothing to do, they cannot act there. But there is another type of cell called the principal cell, which is responsive to the hormones, because conservation of sodium or potassium or calcium is essential along with the acid base. There must be a separate cell type to deal with the acid-base balance along with the electrolyte balance. That is done by the principal cells. The principal cells, the HATPase is there, but there is an activity of the epithelial sodium channel that is called the epithelial sodium channel ENAC in the principal cells. And this has got an is affected by the angiotensin II, aldosterone, calcium sensing receptor. Aldosterone plays a key role, not H1, H plus secretion by stimulating these receptors. So if there is aldosterone, what will happen? There will be a resorption of this one ENAC channel, and HATPase channel is open and hydrogen ion is secreted by that. So aldosterone deficiency is characterized, the aldosterone secretion, what is happening? This hydrogen ion is secreted into the lumen and sodium is retained. That is why in excess aldosteronism, you have sodium retention. Okay. So what you do? You give aldosterone blockers, drugs, so that you counter the aldosterone, allow the sodium to go out and reduce the sodium load. Okay. When there is aldosterone deficiency, that is characterized by sodium wasting, hyperkalemia, and renal tubularesis. What happens when there is a deficiency of aldosterone? These gates are not open, ENAC gate and HATPase gate. So much hydrogen is not secreted into the lumen. Hydrogen is retained in the body. That results in renal tubularesis. Because the hydrogen is not excreted, sodium is wasted because there is nobody to give company, bring back the sodium inside. Sodium wasting. And potassium, whatever is there, in potassium also is reabsorbed. Hyperkalemia, renal tuberculosis are a feature of aldosterone deficiency. The reverse will be the feature of aldosterone excess. So you understand now where are they located? They are not on the basolateral side. They are on the apical side. Hydrogen secretion means going to the apex. This HATPase and the ENAC channels are on the apical side. Ammonia genesis we will take up next class. So today that is, now let us look at the principal cells. That is the principal cell. Principal cell is under the influence of the mineralocorticoid aldosterone. The principal cell is under the influence of the mineralocorticoid aldosterone. So here, this is the water and the sodium are brought into the cell and the potassium is moved in and sodium is sent out. And whenever that is, this is the blood side and this is the luminal side. So whatever luminal sodium is there, it is claimed into the body in case of aldosterone. So aldosterone excess produces excess sodium. In the absence of aldosterone, this gate ENAC and the aquaporin 2 is for the water. The ENAC channel, which we have mentioned in our text there, this is not open. Normally, this channel is opened by an active process, which allows the hydrogen to go here and sodium to come in. That is the epithelial sodium channel. This is again the principal cell. All three types of cells are located on the collecting duct. So the sodium channel is open and water channel is separate channel called the aquaporin channel. Sodium and water are absorbed, and this absorbed sodium is again transported into the blood by sodium potassium exchanger here, and that results in pooling of sodium here, and also water also is absorbed. Sodium and water absorbed means there is edema, hyperaldosteronism, hypervolemia, and all that. And there is a receptor here, mineralocorticoid receptor, which is sensitive to the aldosterone and does all this function. In the absence of aldosterone or deficiency of aldosterone, mineralocorticoid receptor is not open. No sodium is absorbed. Neither the sodium channel here is working. So this channel is also not open. And that results in retention of acid, because acid is not thrown out. That results in renal tubular acidosis. So hypoaldosteronism results in, that's what we have written here, aldosterone deficiency characterized by loss of sodium and excess potassium and renal tubular acidosis. So these are the three types of cells which I wanted to show you, the principal cells, the alpha cells and the beta cells. Now the homework for you for next class is to draw a diagram of the alpha cell and tell me what happens. And what are the channels on the apical side? What are the channels on the basal side? And likewise, draw a diagram of the beta cell. And what are the channels on the alpha, I mean, apical side? And what are the channels on this side? And what is the net outcome and the principal cell? And before that, what are the channels available in the proximal tube? Four diagrams, all of you draw. Proximal tubular cell mechanism, alpha intercalated cell in the collecting tubule, and beta intercalated cell, and then the principal cell. I am going to share you these slides so that you can read them again and on your own draw the diagram and show me that. Apart from the exercise of the acid-base balance, which is already given to you. It's in about 1 hour, then we'll stop here. Then the next class, we will show ammonia formation, physiology of ammonia genesis, which is also essential for acidosis in general, renal tubular acidosis in particular. And after that, of course, we will be dealing with the types of renal tubular acidosis. Is it a deficiency at the proximal tubule? Is it a problem at the DCT? Is it related to genetics? And all those things will come. There are in fact four types, type 1, 2, 3, and 4. We don't have type 3 very much manifest in human beings. We have RTA1, RTA2, and RTA4. How each of them differs from the other, as we proceed, you will be able to understand. So I'm stopping here, but I'm going to share you the presentation up to this point so that you will be able to go through the video as well as the presentation. And the exercise for you is to draw the cells and the mechanisms on the apical side, on the basolateral side, proximal connected tubule. Collecting that head duct has got three types of cells, alpha intercalated, beta intercalated, and the principal cell. If you know this, renal tubular acidosis is on your fingertips. You understand? Like that, when we come to water, I will show you what are the differences and different segments of the nephron, how each segment handles the water separately. Okay, so here I'm going to end it. Any questions from your side?